Hello and welcome back to Mr. Excalibur. My name is Arthur, and today we are looking at the Wind and Thunder Katana by Hanwei. To start this review right off by saying, this thing is a beast. Typically, whenever you hear reviewers refer to it that way, they are of course referring to it being a large, very weighty sword, and this is. This is a very weighty katana. However, I will say that this thing is a very nicely put together katana. This is of course one of Hanwei's mass-produced models. Everything aesthetically about the sword was and is very nice. It has a nice, very straight hamon, temper line along the edge. All the fittings came very nice and tight. The Fushin Kashira had these very nice cast things, and that's actually kind of a standard thing with Hanwei's, and that is their cast ironwork is very good. Even the Saya was very nice. It's a very nice, very clean piano black Saya. It's got some nice shiridomi pieces here right on the kurugata. I think I'm getting that right. I was trying to get the Japanese names for all the parts correct. The Sagaio cord here is a little on the cheapy side. This sword goes for around $700-ish. So this is starting to hit into that upper mid-range of Hanwei swords. The sword came very sharp. You guys will see that in both the cutting and when I unbox it. And really, it is it's a very well-reviewed sword on message boards. If you go on message boards or sword forums, this has been talked about quite a bit. And I think that actually is probably the reason why it hasn't been actually reviewed on YouTube very much. And that is because the big scuttlebutt out there about this sword, it's been around for about 10 years or so. And the information out there was that it's big, it's heavy, it's not going to be something for your everyday use. And I would agree with that. After using it, after trying it, I did find that to be true. I would find that the only downside of this sword, now obviously that's a big one, you're talking about the basic handling of the sword. But other than that, the sword is actually quite nice. It does not have the typical Hanwei handle, which is kind of big, very clunky, very axe handle-ish, and actually tapers somewhat here toward the end, allowing for a nice, second hand down here to control the sword. The Ibarat came very tight. The Samagawa wrap has these very large nodules on it, which is not typical. The Manuki here, the ingots underneath the wrap are very nice. I mean, it is kind of a little frustrating, I guess you could say, from the point of view of it's a nice sword. It's a very nicely put together sword. Probably going to sound like a broken record saying that. But is the weight of this very wide, heavy T10 cutting blade that may not make it very good for your everyday use. You have to know going in that this is going to be a very weighty katana. And if you're okay with that, if you know that going in, this might be worth your money. If you're looking for something that's more of an overall everyday use, you want to practice iaido with it, you want to practice some tamashigiri, you want to actually really take a lot of time swinging the thing around. You do that with this sword, your arms are going to get a little tired. It's kind of like putting those weights on the end of a baseball bat that professional baseball players use in order to warm up before they actually get up to the plate. That's what this thing is kind of like. So overall, my impression is that I liked it, I enjoyed it. Cutting with it is quite a unique experience, and I'll tell you why. One, it does actually recover very nicely. After taking a swing with it, recovering with it is actually pretty easy. It's a peculiar element of how this sword is designed, I have to admit. But the initial slash and the initial cut with that weight coming down is a bit much. Now, to give you an idea of just how weighty this thing is, most katana, because katana are not full tang weapons like European swords are, neither do they have any significant weight right here at the base of the sword, where normally a European sword would have some kind of weighty pommel. That's not an opinion of katana versus European long swords, it's just a mechanical difference. But because of that, katana tend to have more weight forward of the hilt, or in the case of a katana, the tsuba. For an average katana, that point sits about 6 inches or so off the tsuba. This sword, the point of balance is around 7.5 inches, between 7 and 8 inches off the tsuba. That's quite a ways forward here. And you can feel it when you use it. Upcoming, we've got the unboxing footage. This came with some niceties that were nice that I don't think really necessarily added to the value of a sword, but getting a sword at this price point, it was nice to see those things included. You'll see what I'm talking about here in a minute. I've got a few clips of some ooh-ah-oh footage, is what I call footage that's been done of this. Basically, you unwrap it, you take it out of the box, and kind of go, ooh, I'm not taking anything away from people who did that kind of footage, but as of when I made this video, that's all that really existed out there on the internet, with one exception. There was one person that had posted a very old video of some cutting. I've included it here. It's very low res and it's rather old. Probably was made when the sword first came out, but I thought it's worth reintroducing here. So that's what we've got coming up. And then of course, my own cutting with this sword, my new cutting stand. By the time this comes out, I will have already shown some videos using it, but it was a lot of fun to cut with off the new stand. And then, of course, some basic stats of it. Now, I put the general stats, the manufacturer's stats of these swords up there, primarily because there's a certain handmade-ness that all these swords have. And as a result, it doesn't really matter what version I get. Unless you are actually buying this sword from me, if you were to buy this from any one of the distributors that has it, it's gonna be a little bit different. And even Hanwei specifies that in its specs for the sword. So I'll put those out there, generally speaking, what it should be as far as its dimensions, weight, port balance, all that good stuff. And we'll wrap it up there. I hope this has been informative for you. This sword definitely was fun to fool around with. We'll see you next time. And we'll see you next time here at Mr. Excalibur. Bye for now. So here we have the unboxing of the Wind and Thunder Katana by Hanwei. This came to me from... I believe it was the Knife Center, which is another distributor of knives and swords. Came to me with an inner box, then an outer box. I should say inner box within an outer box. And it's always entertaining to open up these Hanwei swords that have this little reminder that I always think is kind of fun to... poke fun at a little bit. But as always, the standard boxing unboxing for Hanwei, they have the standard long box with the various cotton things or styrofoam
fillers in the center, keeping the thing all together. Now, this sword, as I mentioned in the summary intro, came to me at about $700-ish dollars. That's over $700, under $800. So it floats anywhere in that middle. And you can see how it came to me all wrapped up. It did come with a sword cleaning kit, which is kind of interesting considering just recently I bought their Lion Dog katana and it didn't come with one of those, and yet this is a sword that is at a price point that's a little lower than that, and yet they're including one. So not really sure what to make of that other than, well, they go ahead and did it and threw that in. I've had cleaning kits before come to me with various sword manufacturers, and you know, Hanwei being one of them and some of their other ends. Now, one of the other interesting little things that this came with was this really heavily padded sword bag. Again, just recently I got a more expensive sword from Hanwei. Didn't come with these niceties. So it's always interesting when at a certain price point, the manufacturers are throwing in different bells and whistles, I guess you could say. And really why they're doing that is the sword inside not really worth the money? I mean, who knows? But here we go, kind of a better look at it, all unwrapped. But yeah, this sword bag was particularly very padded. I mean, it was a rather heavy thing. I mean, it is probably the heaviest sword bag I have ever seen. there's the cleaning kit. One of the nice things with Hanwei is because they are so large and they're such a big company, they can afford to send along with just about every one of their models all kinds of literature that includes how to tighten up the sword if it's too loose, how to loosen up if it's too tight, how to take apart the sword, how to maintain the sword. And that kind of literature comes standard with a lot of Hanwei models, even ones that don't necessarily come with cleaning kits. The other thing about this sword bag is the cord around it was just really, really, really long. Sorry guys, kind of go on about a sword bag. It just was kind of weird. So here we're finally getting to the meat and potatoes, the actual sword. And the minute I get it out, I immediately can tell this thing weighs a bit. There's my cap. And so just kind of giving it once over now that it's out of the bag. Very nice piano black that they've got on the Saya. Not your typical kind of, you know, run-of-the-mill Saya that has a bunch of scratches and dents and all this kind of stuff. See, even the tags around the sword give you all kinds of information as to you know, what you're supposed to do with it, what you're not supposed to do with it. And so you can't fault Hanwei for not giving a lot of information that is going to help you out when maintaining this thing. One of the nice things about every Hanwei sword, including this one, are the castings of the Fushi, Kashira, the Tsuba, the ironwork in general. This is just something that, you know, we've come to expect from Hanwei's swords. Now, out of the scabbard, it is quite a thing to draw it and put it back in the side. I mean, the weight is so forward that it is, this would be a challenge If you wanted to use this sword for any kind of Yaido practice, any kind of drawing, resheathing, mainly because of just how tip-heavy it is. The sword did come sharp. Now, have I had sharper? Yes. Have I had duller? Definitely. But this thing shaved the paper, so, I mean, it was kind of hard to argue with it. It didn't actually, you know, slice through it like butter, but then again, this is paper, this is that kind of very rudimentary, you know, sharpness test as to, you know, how good is it right out of the box. It was sharp. It was sharp. Was it shaving the back of my arm sharp? No, it wasn't. But I don't think this sword really needed to be that sharp, mainly because of the mass behind the blades. And we'll see that in some of the cutting footage. The handle on the assembly of the sword was very good, like I mentioned in the summary. It has this nice straight hamon temper line right along the edge of the sword. Very neat, very clean. Heavy sword, but very well put together and overall good presentation, at least right out of the box. One of the interesting things I found out about this sword was just how very little out on the internet there is about it. There really is not that much in the way of cutting footage. Here we got one of the only pieces of footage that I could find, and it's got to be at least 10 years old, and you couldn't even find it anymore on YouTube, so I'm sorry I can't credit this with anybody because I couldn't find it. I actually found it on a message board. The guy knows how to handle the sword pretty well. Mountaineer Samurai here did a nice ooh-ah-oh footage, and just so for those listening whose footage this is, ooh-ah-oh is not meant to be demeaning in any way. It really is the kind of let's take it out of the box and see what it looks like, minus any real feeling of how it handles, how it cuts, anything like that. Now, he does make the same comment that a lot of people have made, simply that this one's heavy, and that he kind of liked the very simple hamon edge. Now, one of the reasons why I think there isn't a lot of footage out there is something that I mentioned in the opening, and that is the sword's been around for over 10 years. It came out at the same time as the Great Wave Katana. Both are made with these T10 steel blades. And when it came out, the scuttlebutt, at least on message boards, here's another, some more footage of someone else's copy of it. This was their version of it. One of the things that got out on the message boards, apparently very quickly about this sword, was just how overly heavy it was. Apparently even Matthew Jensen had a copy of this at one time, and to date he has not made any kind of review of it, but he had one and also found it overly heavy. I don't know if he hadn't sold it, but there it is. And I guess when it got out there, I don't know if that kind of hurt the sales of this particular sword or what the case was, but I suspect it's because the information was already out there about it, so no one bothered really to do any kind of extensive video about it. So hopefully this will inform and will provide some information for those of you interested in this model. I would say it's my turn to cut, but we really didn't see many other people doing cutting. So, first off, as you can imagine, while swinging this thing around in the open, the weight of it really does kick in. As I mentioned, the The point of balance on this sword is somewhere between 7 and 8 inches off the tsuba, making it extremely blade heavy. It has quite a blade presence to it. The interesting thing about that, though, is even with its weight so far forward, recovering the sword after a cut actually isn't that hard. Now, holding it out there with one hand and swinging it and letting the thing drop, you really feel the weight coming down. So, as far as Iaido practice, yeah, it really is kind of the, professional baseball player with weights on the end swinging around. It really does kind of feel that way. That doesn't, however, take away from the fact that it actually is a pretty well put together and nice looking sword. It's just a little bit too heavy. Just doing some practice here, a little kata, and just kind of getting the feel for it. And like I said, waiting. But yet, the handle, now the handle, as you guys have seen some up-close footage of, does taper towards the end of the handle. And that made it pretty easy to recover. So, swinging the sword around, like I said, was actually not that hard, although definitely felt the weight of the sword. Now, cutting through any of these bottles really was no issue with this thing. And that is quite honestly due to the fact that it just had an enormous amount of mass. Whoop, got a little water on the camera. And because of that mass, this thing was just going to plow through anything I was going to set it up against, even some of the heavier plastic bottles. Although I have to say, doesn't matter how sharp or how heavy the thing is, bad edge alignment is bad edge alignment, and I threw some in there just to show you, guys, doesn't matter how good the thing is. As Sean Connery said in Highlander, sometimes, McLeod, the sharpest blade is not enough. And apparently that was true. In one particular case here. So, but it's still a lot of fun, still cool to cut with. But I gotta repeat this, guys. Here we go. So, here's what I think. Boing! Yeah. Let's try it one more time. Yeah! Okay, just kind of just smashed it. So, anyway. it's a T10 blade. T10 is a little different than 1095, which means if you put it away after whacking around all these water bottles, the thing is going to rust. So please clean it off. That's what I use the WD-40 for. Not necessarily to really lubricate it, but just to kind of clean off all the muck I just plowed through. Then wipe it off, put maybe some other kind of oil in on there. I suggest maybe 3-in-1 oil. It's a nice thin common oil. And put it away so you have it to play with on another day.